Hello, my name is Marcus. I'm the compiler of a collection of therapy quotes entitled 1001 Windmills of the Mind, a collection of quotes taken from what's often called the psychodynamic or the psychoanalytic perspective, which long ago, as I understand it, was called philosophical medicine, because this perspective seeks to augment, transmute, transfigure our memories so that if we do have, or if one does have, unhappy memories which are still affecting them in the present, we can witness them and add some understanding to them so that we transmute or change the effect they have on us. In other words, we're trying to heal the inner child, or we're trying to unpick the threads of a traumatic script. Eric Byrne likes to talk about scripts. And use those threads to weave a new, healthier script. These quotes are helping us to be our own caring witness, because grief is healed when it's witnessed by a caring person or a caring other. And to some extent, we can be our own caring other with the understanding. With the understanding that leads to forgiveness. Okay, so the forgiveness is being a caring witness. Right. These quotes are helping us to be our own existential detective, to help us, well, to use Eric Byrne's model, to identify, he calls them, well, his jargon is, he uses very informal jargon. He says that a lot of our childhood, based on painful childhood memories, we create interactions with people based on those childhood experiences. And he calls these interactions with people games. That's his jargon. So his famous book is called Games People Play. And he has cataloged, I guess, over several dozen of them, if not more, of these kinds of repetitive behavior based on a painful childhood past. So to be our own existential detective, it's to recognize which one of these patterns are we repeating in the, right, over and over again, like Sisyphus, based on what we learned in childhood, to see if we can get a better outcome. Right. These quotes are helping us to so when we be our own existential detective, I think the main work is to, similar to what Eric Byrne is talking about, to notice the repetitive pattern that's dysfunctional, when it began, and then to see it in the here and now. Actually, come to think of it, Eric Byrne pretty much says that. Yeah. Although his model is considered CBT, he does have a blend between a psychoanalytic perspective and CBT. So this reference to Eric Byrne is in the last video. So I'm just sort of following up from the last video, TQ 1907 to 1917. If I can refer you to that video, there's some talk about Eric Byrne's work. His work is not a thread in this collection of quotes, but I do include a few of his quotes in this collection. And I'll include a few more. But it's not the focus of this collection. The focus of this collection is to kind of is what's called developmental object relations theory, right? Based primarily on the work on the works of Margaret Mahler, Melanie Klein, William Fairbairn, as clarified by James F. Masterson. So Masterson is sort of a key guiding mentor in this collection of quotes. He has a great book called The Search for the Real Self. Yeah. These quotes, we now have over 1,900 quotes in this area. And I think these quotes are helping us to weave a basket. These quotes won't give anybody an egg, but we need the basket for the egg to arrive. So one poet says, psychoanalysis, always looking for an egg in a basket that's missing. So these quotes are helping to weave this basket with the 30 plus threads that we now have, right? So this, all of these quotes make up roughly 30 threads or themes or topics that run throughout. Right? So one threat is the psychodynamics of myths and fairy tales. Right? Myths and fairy tales are true on the inside, not on the outside. Right? They're soul stories. They describe the inner world. Right? Myths and fairy tales describe a traumatized psyche, because a common motif or fairy tale or mythological motif, meaning psychological motif, is splitting. You have the goddess and the demon. Right? So that there, called splitting, that's a threat in itself. Splitting is meant to be existential hearsay by the age of three. But if the child is so frustrated, so all children temporarily use splitting in the beginning because of their small size. Good breast, bad breast, good mother, bad mother. They're bonded to the frightening mother to have the attachment, but they fantasize that they're bonded to a good mother so they can safely feed. That's called splitting. But by the age of three, the child is wiser. He figures out that the mother's just one person, emotionally, perceptually, cognitively, right? But if the mother is more frustrating than loving, he still uses splitting. That can lead to prejudice, that can prevent access to the real self, that blocks the appearance of the true self. Splitting precludes mourning. If a person doesn't mourn losses, that can lead to complicated grief. You know. So we have a threat on splitting, what's called the moral defense, identification with the aggressor. If the baby is so frustrated with the mother, they just become like her and then do to others what was done to them to communicate what was done to them. Right. So identification with the aggressor often leads to what's called negative magic gesture. Doing to others what was done to you to communicate what was done to you. Right. To show up the mother. That's called the negative magic gesture. We have a threat on rationalization. This is when you want to give the appearance of being rational to protect the false self. Right. Another threat, the false self. What is the false self? Right. So in the last video, we talked a little bit about the false self. We have a thread on the psychodynamics of the body bears the burden. So this first quote here in this batch relates to our thread on the body bears the burden, the mysterious sleep between mind and body. Right? We often forget about this connection between the mind and body. And this quote emphasizes this point. So we'll start off with that one there. We have a thread on the psychodynamics of prejudice. If a child felt unloved, it's repressed. When something's repressed, it's projected. If it's projected, it's seen outward. And then the person might do to them what the mother did to them. That can lead to prejudice. Right? Now, because of the fusion, the baby's mind and the mother's mind are one. If the person identifies with the aggressor and he sees his unloved self onto others, when he makes some devaluing or uses cynical humor on them or something, puts them down, so to speak, because of the fusion, they just felt that the other was the aggressive mother putting them down. Then they do to them, so in other words, they devalue others and they feel devalued and they think they've just been devalued in the process. And they're stuck like Sisyphus, like a loop. So the narcissistic pattern is consistently negative and cynical and greedy, envious, spiteful, and vindictive. And their sense of pleasure is called schadenfreude. When they are the stinger, put the others down, they feel one up. Right? So from the baby's point of view, he was no good. The mother was one up. The baby's presence for the mother provided the mother some safety and comfort, so she got serotonin. Now the child identifies with the aggressor. So how does he get serotonin? He does to others what his mother did to him. I see. So we have a thread on the psychodynamics of prejudice, a thread on the Jocasta style of mothering, a thread on Laius, a thread on the story of Orestes, the thread on the story of the Odyssey. We have a thread on Chinnan's work called Middle Tales. This is excellent. Alan Chinnan read through over 7,000 fairy tales and plucked out over 50, which represent the second journey of life, or the hero's journey, meaning the midlife audit, from 40 to 60 on average. Robert Bly says it's at least 15 years. For him, it was 35 to 50, he said. It can happen later. A person can start At 60 and finish at 80 or something. It's not really too much, it's not too set on a specific set of years or time. So roughly in the middle period of life somewhere, a person questions things, looks for the script, right? And if they had an insecure attachment style, that's a trauma. When there's a trauma, they're going to repeat that script over and over again, right? Thinking that they're going to get some kind of better outcome because that script is painful. That's why they're repeating it, thinking they can get a better result. It can't be done. It's a secondary delusion. So they're stuck like that. And by midlife, a person says something's wrong. What's he doing? Why is he repeating the same dysfunctional thing over and over again? Now he's getting older, right? And it's not working. So now he has to go on this second journey. So this is, required reading. So these 50 tales have been put into four books. Once Upon a Midlife, In the Ever After. There's one for men called Beyond the Hero, and one for women called Beyond the Princess. But the title of that book, the one Beyond the Princess, he changed the title. It's called Waking the World. But this is good for men as well. And Beyond the Hero is good for women as well. Basically, at midlife, we try to reclaim what we lost. So we have a thread on emotional eating. It's an exciting, in-depth collection of quotes. I feel very kind of encouraged and nourished and inspired by this collection of quotes myself. And we're adding more quotes to it. So let's add a quote to our thread on the one about the link between the connection between the mind and the body. Often the word mind and body is printed as one word, body mind or mind body. Sarno likes to do that. He calls it the mind body or body mind, right? So this author here, he was just sort of talking. I saw this on an interview. If you go to YouTube, look up. Is it Richard Lombardi? It's in Italian, but there are English subtitles. So I just took out a few of his statements there. So let's add this quote here to our thread on the body bears the burden. Okay, he says here, according to the English translation, The traditional psychoanalytic approach, okay, which is what this, which is what 1001 Windmills of the Mind is all about, the psychoanalytic approach, both traditional and sort of updated versions of it. Okay, the psychoanalytic approach takes for granted. So we often take for granted that there is this body-mind integration connection. He says, well, you know, I think we take that for granted. He says, I think that integration is not always a given fact. He doesn't buy it. He thinks, you know, we're too intellectual with our theories and our jargon. We're keeping too much in the head. We're spinning around with these thoughts. What about the body? Well, the assumption, well, generally, that's what all this is about, to heal the feeling self, to bring the feelings back into the body. So we need the mind to feel safe, to bring back the feelings. So it's already assumed. But sometimes it becomes like a red herring. People get caught down this endless track of becoming too philosophical, too intellectual. And then that becomes a defense mechanism to not be aware of the feelings. So now they're overly engaged in this defense mechanism called intellectualization, right? He says a lot of people are engaged in this, and they're not interpreting or recognizing it. Right? So that's his point. So he's calling out what's called intellectualization. When there is too much of a gap between the mind and the body, for example, as in the schizoid pattern. Yeah, so in the schizoid pattern, a lot of philosophers have the schizoid pattern. Yeah. Their emotions are withdrawn. They emotionally move away from people. So Karen Horney's jargon is moving toward, away, or against. So the schizoid, they move on the Enneagram, it's the five. Or if it's the unhealthy five, then they really move away emotionally. So they don't want close emotional relationships. So the emotions are withdrawn. It's not gone, it's just very withdrawn. And to keep it withdrawn, they take refuge in intellectualization. So they may become a philosopher, but that's the positive intention of becoming a philosopher, let's say, is to build the ego, to build that basket, right? So the egg can, so the feelings can come in, but maybe they forget about it. So maybe they, that's his point. Let's not forget about the feelings. The feelings are in the body. So when he says the body, he means the feelings, right? That the feeling self is animated through the body. So when he says the body, that's an abbreviation for our animated feelings coming through, vibrating through the body. We have this energy in the body and so on, right? However we describe it. Now, he said he calls this gap between the mind and the body, and he says there's a disharmonious condition. So he just says it in general terms. He doesn't like jargon. He says, well, let's just temporarily say that there's some disharmony here between the mind and the body. Or commonly we might say a situation of body-mind disassociation. Body-mind disassociation. So in recent videos, we did that with Michelangelo, that painting of Narcissus. He was staring at his reflection in the pool of water and echoes off to the side. Okay. Or in Peer Gynt, Solvig is at a distance. So these characters, Echo and Solvig, right, they represent their fantasized personifications of their feelings, but it's disassociated. He's away from his feelings. So Peer Gynt was always chasing, running away from his feelings. Narcissus ignored his feelings. Right. So that's the gap there. Now Odysseus is the hero, because Odysseus, he resisted the temptation to ignore his feelings. The sirens say, oh, you can just ignore the feelings. He resisted that temptation. So Odysseus is a hero because he accepted his feelings. Okay, so that's the metaphor for that is he was reunited with Penelope. So that's just, Penelope is a symbol for his feelings. They're not separate characters in some external world. The whole Odyssey is like a dream describing the internal theater. Okay, the analytic relationship. So next part here. The analytic relationship is like a boat in which two people must row. Now, if only one person rows, the boat will go in circles and the therapy will go nowhere. So the interviewer was asking, you know, it's not just about the client being passive and the therapist does all the work. He's not supposed to feed. It has to be a conscious participation between two people. It's two people working on the problem together. That's what he means. So that's his metaphor, that therapy is like two people in a boat. In order to get anywhere, both have to be consciously, actively involved, right? If the therapist does all the work, it doesn't go anywhere. You can think about a relationship between a narcissistic pattern and a codependent pattern. In the relationship goes nowhere because the codependent pattern, she's doing all the work. That's why she gets fed up. So we played that song recently by Gabriel. It's give and take. Right? She means a relationship is two people in a relationship going together forward. So we played that one there. So maybe we'll play that song again at the end there. A great song by Gabriel called Give and Take. About the boat. Okay, he says that, I strongly require the participation of the client because he or she is the only one who really knows what's happening inside himself. As the old saying goes, only the spoon knows what is boiling in the pot. Okay. So he reinforces that the therapist is not some magician. He doesn't know what the other person is feeling. Only the feeler knows what he's feeling, just like only the... So there's the metaphor, right? Only the spoon knows what's in the pot, right? So the client's feeling self in the body, in other words, the client's emotions and his feelings in the body, it is the true north. This is the guide. This is the true north of the analytic or the therapeutic compass. Okay? The compass. I feel, therefore I am. We're looking for the I am. We need the feelings. So the feelings lead to the I am. So this is the analytic compass, right? How do you feel, right? Ontological feelings, right? Not judgments about your epistemological self, right? But feelings from your psychological self or ontological self, right? So again, we have the me. That's your role, you know, your profile, your resume, your social activities. That's the me part. What about, but how do you feel about the me? Okay, that's the I, that's the ontological self. So the ontological self, he calls this is the guide. This is the true analytic compass, right? And only the client has his ontological self. The therapist doesn't have the client's ontological self, right? The therapist has to be responsible, okay? But to help the client, at the same time, the therapist has to be responsible for his internal world before he can functionally establish a relationship with the client. Okay, so he has to be sort of in touch with his self, because usually there's what's called projective identification. The client wants the therapist to feel what he's feeling. So he wants to coax the therapist to feel what he's feeling because the client wants to communicate what he's feeling, but he doesn't know what he's feeling. So he wants to push the therapist's buttons. Now, if the therapist's buttons are pushed, he may act out and he himself may project the refusing mother onto the client and then be angry at the client. So the therapist has to stay in touch with his ontological self for this to work. Otherwise, it doesn't work, right? Okay, it is important, therefore, as therapists to have an integrated vision that involves the body and not only the mind. So a good therapist, has a connection to his body, in other words. This body-mind issue runs throughout all of psychoanalysis and is a central problem in all treatments, not only with psychosomatic clients. The body is a central issue in any current treatment, even in clients who are more integrated, and represents an area where psychoanalysis can be expanded. If we consider the body only in relation to psychosomatic clients, in my view, we will be reductionists. Okay, by horizontal, I mean the relational capacity of the client with the other person, interpersonal, it's like a horizontal relationship. And the vertical relationship, okay, that's the body-mind connection, that's within. Now these two, the interpersonal and the intrapsychic, are closely related and involve the philosophical, epistemological, okay, problems which have occupied the entire development of human thought. Okay, so who we are and how do we relate to others, in other words. We as human beings or Homo sapiens need both axes to move forward. Even though taking both into account implies a great level of complexity, which has to be respected. So you're saying, let's have some empathy for ourselves and for others. We're all struggling with this basic question of who am I? Yeah. And then in their relationships with others, what are they doing with others? Well, like Eric Byrne says, they're replaying a childhood scene with they're replaying a painful childhood scene with their parents into the present. So that's the interpersonal. Yeah. Because ultimately he's trying to find a balance between his vertical so that he can relate in a more realistic, healthy way in the present. Here's that one about projective identification. Okay, in projective identification, okay, the projector may stir up within the therapist an experiential state that to some degree matches or complements the projector's immediate self-experience. Projective identification, although having intrapsychic, okay, that's the vertical, characteristics, represents and interactional phenomena. Okay, that's the horizontal, in which the projector, okay, by actual influence, unconsciously elicits or triggers thoughts, feelings, and experiences within the other person, which in some way resemble his own. Okay, that's a pretty good quote on our thread on projective identification. So the source of this theory about projective identification is that the baby in the womb gets all of their needs met automatically. Fair enough. In the extended womb, so the first 5 months is called the extended womb, a social womb. Right? It's like an egg. The womb life continues. What if the mother's misattuned? The baby's expecting unconditionally to have his needs met unconditionally. The baby's needs got unconditionally met in the womb. In the extended womb, that's meant to continue. What if the mother's on the phone too long? Or what if she's misattuned or reading a book and ignores the child? So the child has a concept that the mother or the breast mother, from the Melanie Klein thinks at the very beginning, the child relates to a breast mother more than just a separate person. And this breast, right, the theory is it's just there to serve him. It's just there to serve him. For the baby, it's all about the baby and what is around him, meaning the breast mother or the mother. The mother's just there to serve him, and that's right. He's right. Right? He's still developing. He just came out of the womb. Well, humans come out too early. It should be all about him. Right? Now, what if the mother says, no, what about me? And she ignores the baby's needs. So the baby will have a lot of feelings. Now, because of the fusion with the mother, it's as if, the theory is, we can imagine it, just to describe it in some way, we can just imagine it that it's not actually the case, but just to somehow describe the situation, it's as if, imaginarily, the baby's trying to get the mother to feel what he's feeling. Because if the mother's feeling what he's feeling, that means the baby made the mother attuned. The role of the mother, in particular during the first 5 months, is to be perfectly attuned, attunement to the baby's needs, so she can automatically, unconditionally meet the baby's needs just like they were met in the womb. Right? So if the mother's misattuned, the baby wants the mother to be attuned. How does the baby make the mother attuned? He will make sounds or gestures or be uncomfortable or maybe cry or show signs of distress. And he may even get, it appears as if the baby even wants to coax the mother to feel what he's feeling. That's the imagination of it all. To get the mother to have some empathy for what the baby's feeling. Now, finally, the mother goes, oh my God, the baby's feeling too cold. Let's get him a blanket. So he gets it. So it worked, right? Now, what if there's a problem in this area and it didn't work? That's a trauma. That's the last desperate attempt the baby has to communicate his feeling state to his mother, is to coax her to feel what he's feeling so she can get it and be attuned and meet the baby's needs. Now, what if that fails and he tried his best and he couldn't do it and it's stuck? Oh boy. The rest of his life, he may become very provocative towards others, coaxing others, pushing their buttons, triggering others, like Eric Byrne says, playing these games to get other people upset because he's upset. Yeah? So the baby was upset because he's scared. He wants the mother to, it's as if he wants the mother to be upset and scared. So the mother, she's the giant, she's the all-powerful one, she can handle it, right? Then the mother gets the message, she meets the baby's needs. So it's as if the baby is trying to get the mother to feel what he's feeling. Right? Now, if this fails and the baby's traumatized by this, he's got to master this trauma. He's got to master the trauma of being able to get his mother to be attuned to him. That's a trauma. When there's a trauma, there's repetition compulsion. So he can go through life constantly looking for other people's weak spots or vulnerable spots, pushing their buttons, getting them angry. Now they feel angry. That's the projector's way of communicating that when they were a baby, they were angry at their mother, and they're coaxing the mother to be angry. Now this person in the present, who's now annoyed, they're just going to run away, of course, or be angry back or something, right? But the baby would rather have the mother to be angry at them than to ignore them. The baby would rather have a negative relationship with the mother than no relationship with the mother. So Eric Byrne actually has a term for this dynamic. I'll refer you to his book. He has two good books, Games People Play, and his last book called What Do You Say After Hello? Those two books in particular. And the Harris book, the I'm Okay, You're Okay book as well. I think those three books give you a pretty good summary of a lot of this projective identification. So projective identification, I'm wondering in my mind now if I'm getting this point across. It's a key concept. It's a major thread throughout this series. We must now have at least 50 or 60 or 70 excellent quotes on this topic of projective identification. Now, sometimes it's very benign. Two friends get together. Friend A is feeling a little anxious. Friend B at the beginning was calm. After half an hour, friend B starts to feel anxious himself. So B picks up on it and thinks to himself, maybe my friend A is anxious. Let's talk about it. So friend B says, hey, friend A, you know, I'm starting to feel a little anxious, but when I got here a half an hour ago, I was feeling pretty good. Now I'm feeling anxious. I'm wondering if maybe you too, if you also are feeling anxious about something, but you're not talking about it. Are you feeling anxious about something in your life? Is something going on? And friend A will say, oh my God, I'm glad you brought this up. And because you're right, I am. I am feeling anxious about something. I didn't want to talk about it, but you noticed it and you're picking it up. Oh, I'm sorry about that. So, okay, with friend B says, well, that's good. Well, let's clear this. What is it? So it's benign that way. So a friend can pick up on the other person's emotions, raise the issue, and then the first person confesses, I didn't realize I was feeling anxious. I sort of knew it, but I didn't really know it. But since you brought it up, it makes me aware that I know it. So projective identification can be benign like that, right? Sometimes in a second scenario is misery loves company. If the guy's unhappy about something, he wants to coax the other person to be unhappy, right? In projective identification, the projector may stir up within the other person an experiential state that to some degree matches or complements the projector's immediate self-experience. Okay? Projective identification, although having intrapsychic qualities, okay, that's within, so the projector is feeling sad, it represents an interactional phenomena, so he's talking with his friend, that's the horizontal, in which the projector, okay, the one who's sad, somehow manages to elicit sad feelings in the other person. Okay, now the other person is now feeling something that's very similar to what the projector is feeling. So that's sort of the positive intention of why he's coaxing the other to feel what he's feeling so he doesn't feel so alone. So we're calling that misery loves company, right? Another variation, a third scenario is when the person's true self got squelched when he was growing up as a baby. So he has what's called the hungry, enraged, empty part self, or the shame self, the humiliated self. So his true self got unwelcomed, right? That's repressed. He's not aware of it. That's just a metaphor for meaning he's not aware of it. Now, when he's not aware of it, he sees it outward to make sure he stays unaware of it. His goal is to remain unaware of it, because to be aware of it would bring up the furies, the persecutory anxiety or the massive anxiety of being reminded of how the mother was so rejecting and refusing. So his purpose is to remain unaware that his true self is now what's called the despised self or the rejected self or the shamed self. So to not be aware of that, he will say others are despicable or shamed or no good or something like that. Okay, so prejudice can come from there. So the purpose of prejudice is for the projector to preserve his to preserve him being unaware that he feels those things that he's attributing to the other person. Yeah. So again, the baby makes this false conclusion that he's no good. Okay. He can't feel it. He then says others are no good. Now, the more he says others are no good, that allows him to be in denial of how he feels that when he was a baby, that he came up with this false belief that he's no good. Right? So that's his agenda for prejudice. Now, what if the other person is not demonstrating some traits of this negativity? Then he'll coax the other, or push, or get them, or arrange the other to show some sign of something negative, and then says, aha, see, I told you he's negative, right? He can do some trivial little thing that means nothing, and he'll just blow it up because his agenda is to have some excuse, rationalization, okay, an excuse to preserve the projection, to preserve the repression, right? To keep the furies at bay because he can't feel the persecutory anxiety. Again, in the story of Orestes, Orestes was unloved by his mother, but he wants to find himself anyways. So the first thing he does is he says to his mother, Mother, I didn't like how you treated me when I grew up. Now the mother's going to use guilt trip tactics. How dare you, what I did for you. And so he's going to say, no, I don't like you using guilt trip tactics. The mother might threaten, well, I'm just going to ignore you from now on. Well, fine, I'll go on my own then. Really, you can handle it? You can't handle it. Yes, I can. So Orestes tried to separate from his mother, but he felt the abandonment depression of that. Because normally a child needs love to be himself, but Orestes never got that love. So he still wants to be himself despite that. So now he's on the journey to be himself. He feels the feelings of that. Those feelings are shown in story form as the furies. The furies are a personification or a symbol of that massive anxiety called persecutory anxiety. Okay. Now Orestes is a hero because he stuck with that journey. He tied himself to the mast. He didn't listen to the sirens like, you know. So we can flip back and forth between Orestes and Odyssey. They're similar stories. Both stories are for separation and individuation, right? And Orestes faced the two sides of the mother. Once in the courtroom scene, half was good, half was against. That represents the balance between seeing the mother as partly loving and partly frustrating and being able to handle that ambivalence. If he can get to that place, if he can heal the splits, bring the two sides together, okay, nature's innate drive for healing can be symbolized as Athena. Athena says, yes, okay. So he succeeded. Now the Furies became the gentle ones. So in the beginning, Orestes was afraid of his feelings. Now his feelings served him. Okay, they became the centuries, the Eumenides. They served him. We feel, therefore we are. So if he knows his feelings, he knows who he is. So they serve him. That's why they call it the centuries, right? Orestes. Okay, again. Oh yeah, about projective identification. So that's another way, another reason why a person might use projective identification. To preserve the ability to not be reminded of the furies because he can't face it. He doesn't have the cup. He doesn't have the basket. Okay. The basket is a symbol for ego strength, for awareness, for consciousness, for knowledge. He doesn't have the knowledge. He doesn't have the awareness that in childhood trauma, the ego gets submerged. The ego gets lost. So he wants to find his ego. How do we find the ego? Well, he can read books and he can listen to lectures and talk to others and so on. Right? Because he wants to give himself basic trust. The baby needs basic trust to know himself. But in trauma, the baby didn't get that basic trust. Okay. So every baby's born with original trust, original faith, but they lost it. Right? So now we have to give it to ourselves. Right? So it's sometimes called self-reparenting, sometimes called the Odyssey, sometimes called the second journey. self-awareness movement, the know thyself movement, the mental, emotional, spiritual hygiene movement. Wilson calls it the moral revolution to heal ourselves. Bergler is very direct. Bergler says, you're responsible for your unconscious, the bag you drag behind us. That's the unconscious. Masterson says, yeah, you got to heal the inner child of the past. Okay, so that's projective identification. Okay, speaking of Eric Byrne, maybe we'll add two or three of his quotes here. Okay, maybe before we move on to Eric Byrne, let's see how we're doing. How are we doing outside here? Okay. I would clear it up here. Oh, it's a nice. Yeah. Well, it's a nice day today, actually. Yeah, look at that. Still no sign of the eagle and the fox and the blue jay. The animals have been very quiet this winter. Okay, so just again, can I refer you to the last video marked at TQ 1907 to 1917? We talked about Eric Byrne in those two videos. In part two, right? So just a quick recap. So Eric Byrne. Okay, he's famous for this book called Games People Play. Best-selling book, 1964, right? And his main idea, is that here's a person in their mind. They have the adult ego state. That's the reasonable, conscious, adult mind, right? Right? So this can see patterns and it's conscious and reasonable. This is the child ego state and the parent ego state. So the child ego state, it still thinks that I'm not okay and others are okay. Okay, but sometimes they identify with the abusive mother. That becomes the parent ego state. The abusive mother has the attitude, well, I'm okay and you're not okay. So if it's with another person, he says, I'm okay and you're not okay, or something like that. So, Only adult to adult is I'm okay, you're okay. This is normal, natural, healthy development. But what sometimes happens is people may pretend to have an adult to adult conversation, but unconsciously, this person may be emotionally feeling like a child and he projects his parent onto him, or he may be critical towards him. Right? Now, it doesn't have to be negative. He may project a loving parent onto him, and he may have sympathy for the child in him, or it can be, so it can work both ways. Sometimes people interact child to child or parent to parent, or it can flip around a little bit. So Eric Byrne listed the various variations that this can take. Right? And so you can see it here. He broke down his games into life games, marriage games, social games, right? Therapy games. And he has some good games there and so on, right? So I'm not sure what the actual number is, but it takes a lot of work. So you can see the games. Some of the most common ones are here. Let's play another clip of his. So here's Eric Byrne here. And so here's an example of what he's talking about. We played one clip in the last video, so we'll play another clip here.
Let's take as a theoretical example, a man who comes in and talks about relationships, and we discover what he really means is when he goes to a party where there are strangers, his stomach feels funny. Well, the first thing we do is talk about parent, adult, and child. In that case, it's very obvious that it's the child part of him that feels funny because at an adult level or at an objective level, nobody at the party is going to hurt him or we say something as your child, that's only our opinion. And in order to verify it, we have to go through certain procedures. One of them is to find out, did you really feel that way when you were actually a child? And if he did, then we say, well, our diagnosis is right. That's the child part of you. So it's very easy to trace back in such cases that same thing happened when he went to kindergarten the first day or when he went to birthday parties. So we set up the child and the adult. And then it's a little more difficult, but not too difficult, to establish that it's something about the way his parents raised him which contributed to his child being scared in that situation. For instance, they may have been hammering at him, watch your manners, to take a very simple example. He goes to the party and he's scared that he may do something rude and his parents would be angry at him, and then let's say all the other kids are going to have better manners than he has, and so they'll jump on him, and that scares him. So in that way, we set up the parent-adult child first. Then the next step would be to talk about some of the transactions with other people, because...
Okay, again?
As a theoretical example, a man who comes in and talks about relationships, and we discover what he really means is when he goes to a party where there are strangers, his stomach feels funny. Well,
Okay, so there's a link between the body and the mind. Eric Byrne is saying, well, how do you feel in your sensations? Right? So there's that Lombardi one. He says, well, only the spoon knows what's in the pot. So he has to check. Only the other person can answer that question, right?
First thing we do is talk about parent, adult, and child.
Okay, so so again, this is CBT. He's consciously explaining the idea of the three ego states, the child mind, the adult mind, and the parent mind. Now, the parent mind is the inner critic. It's actually another child mind. So anger is in the parent mind, not the adult mind. If the child identifies with the aggressor, that's the parent mind. Right, so that's the angry, the critical mind, right? So he's explaining that we have these three minds. It's just step one, right?
In that case, it's very obvious that it's the child part of him that feels funny because...
Okay, so he has social anxiety. He goes to a cocktail party or something, a wine taste. He goes, and he's nervous. Well, wait a minute. Which mind is making him nervous? There's no reason to be nervous. Everyone's relaxed, sipping some wine or something. There's no reason to be afraid, but he's afraid. So that's the child mind. Oh, okay. So you recognize, well, that's the child mind. So the social environment triggers the child mind. That's his model, right?
At an adult level or at an objective level, nobody at the party is going to hurt him or wants to hurt him. There's nothing to be afraid of. So then we trace that back and discover that is so. See, if we say something as your child, that's only our opinion. And in order to verify it, we have to go through certain procedures. One of them is...
Okay, so that's the soup. That's the spoon in the soup. That's the spoon in the pot. He's saying, well, we may think he's operating from the child mind, but we need him to realize that that's the child mind. So he says we trace it back. Well, when you were a child in social environments, how did you feel when you were in social environments? Then the person goes, oh my God, that's right. When I was in social environments, I felt queasy. Just like now, I feel queasy. Oh, I get it. That's the child mind. That's his point there, right?
Just to find out, did you really feel that way when you were actually a child? And if he did, then we say, well, our diagnosis is right. That's the child part of you. So it's very easy to trace back in such cases that same thing happened when he went to kindergarten the first day or when he went to birthday parties. So we set up the child and the adult. And then it's a little more difficult, but not too difficult, to establish that it's something about the way his parents raised him which contributed to his child being scared in that situation. For instance, they may have been hammering at him, watch your manners, to take a very simple example. He goes to the party and he's scared that he may do something rude and his parents would be angry at him, and then let's say all the other kids are going to have better manners than he has, and so they'll jump on them, and that scares them. So in that way, we set up the parent-adult child first. Then the next step would be to...
Okay, the next step will be to... basically, in effect, he's saying the next step would be to buy his book because he lists the scripts that come about, that spring forth from the original fearful conditioning that took place as a child. So the fearful conditioning took place as a child, and he's repeating it again and again. Now this repetition compulsion can take a variety of different forms. This variety of different forms he lists in his two books there, Games People Play and What Do You Say After Hello? So he updated it in his last book called What Do You Say After Hello? So yeah, he's blending the psychoanalytic with the CBT. So we'll do, so on Wikipedia here, so somebody asked the question, what are games according to Eric Burns? There's his book there. Okay, he says, the answer here is, according to Dr. Byrne, games are ritualistic transactions or behavior patterns between individuals that can indicate hidden feelings or emotions. Well, that's as simple and clear as it gets. Okay, so this repetition compulsion, he calls them a game. They are ritualistic. Okay, like a ritual. Over Sisyphus. Okay, they're Sisyphus behaviors between individuals that indicate hidden feelings. Now, in this links to our quote on projection. Projection is the means of bringing repressed material to consciousness. So here, this repetition compulsion, this quote game, ritualistic transactions, right? So if he has a script that says he can't trust anybody, he'll always look for evidence that people can't be trusted, or something like that. Then he says, aha, I knew it. That was his game, right? Because he wants to communicate that when he was a child, he trusted his mother, but it got squelched, and he's stuck there, and he's trying to communicate that. So these activities, these ritualistic transactions, are like a mirror for bringing repressed material, meaning repressed feelings, okay, hidden feelings, that's repressed material, right? So they're like a mirror. According to Dr. Byrne, repetition compulsion or Sisyphus repetitive behavior, doing the same thing over and over again, okay, between individuals, they indicate they are a mirror. They are a mirror for hidden feelings. They're trying to make the person conscious. It's a lot of work to read his books. He writes, it's exhausting. I read his book just in small doses. We'll do a couple of his quotes then here. For example, if Miss Juliet or whatever, Miss J, anybody there, right? The client signals that she is available, right, to the guy, and then she enjoys how the man is chasing her. But as soon as he has committed himself to the chase, she gives up. She says, oh, quote, I appreciate your compliments and thank you for your attention. Okay. Now he feels disappointed. Her primary gratification comes from enjoying his pain after she rejects him. Okay, so this woman is vindictive, and she's stuck there. So she has a game that when she was a child, she needed her mother's attention, she didn't get it, she's angry, right? So she's vindictive. So she goes through life wanting to entice people to show an interest in them, So then what she would do is reject them, just like she was rejected when she was a baby. But this time, she wants to enjoy the one-up position. So now the victim is feeling sad that she rejected him, and that puts her in the one-up position, and then she feels pleasure. So that's her game. So this is actually similar to a negative magic gesture, right? So when she was a baby, she had a wish. Okay. She was in the one-down position. The mother was in the one-up position. The mother in the one-up position rejected her. Okay. Now, that pain is too much to accept. The baby gives up, identifies with the aggressor. Okay. Now, the mother got serotonin. So the theory about that is if the mother gets some kind of a feeling of safety with her child, she gets serotonin. So the mother put the baby down. Okay. So the mother's in the one-up position over the baby. The mother rejects the baby, she feels one-up. The brain sends the person serotonin. Now the baby identifies with the aggressor. Now how is she going to get serotonin? She mimics what the mother did because she is the mother. She adopted her mind as her mind. So she goes to the cocktail party, whatever, shows interest in all of these people. For the purpose of rejecting them, seeing them hurt and painful and upset and sad, shamed, discomfort her, okay? There's uneasy and squirming and pain, okay? Now, that means she got the one-up position over the guy. She was not interested in finding a boyfriend or whatever. She was only interested in putting him down so she can get serotonin. Okay. Now this behavior, this racket or game, Eric Byrne calls it, this is a mirror for her to see, for the woman herself to see, to recognize that when she herself was a baby, that's what happened to her. She's trying to communicate what happened to her. So when she entices the other, rejects them, sees the guy hurt and disappointed, and she feels good about it, that behavior is a mirror for her to see that when she was a baby, she felt enticed, got rejected, and felt pain. You see? Now that guy there, the victim there, he's not going to say, "Oh, did you show promising signs so that you can say thank you very much, goodbye, and see me disappointed? Is that something related to what happened to you when you were very young?" He's not going to do that, right? Now, what one quote is that what she's really doing is she's talking to the mother in the mind because it's herself. She's blended there, right? She's saying to the mother in the mind, "Look, mother in the mind, see that innocent guy there trying so hard to please me? And how I rejected them and they feel pain. You see what I did to that innocent guy there? Well, that's what you did to me and I didn't like it, and I'm showing you through my behavior." So she's in battle with the mother in the mind, right? Now, if she's not aware of this, she can get stuck there. It's like a moment, and she's stuck in this moment, and she's going to repeat it over and over again like Sisyphus, right? So Eric Byrne would have a name for this racket. Right? If you read the book, you'll find the name for it. I didn't include it here. I don't personally like some of his slang for these terms. I don't know how helpful they are, but it is helpful. The main exercise with Eric Byrne's book is to read through those tactics there. And like Eric Byrne says, you're going to recognize at least one of them for yourself, or you're going to identify it as someone else doing it. Yeah. Okay, another one. Okay, this one I included the name here. So this, here's another example called, he calls this one a shamil, whatever that means. Okay, I haven't really looked into it, but so one of his games is called shamil. I think it's Dutch or German or something, not really sure. Okay, the real payoff, the real benefit, okay, in this so-called repetition compulsion is not the pleasure of being disruptive, okay, which is merely an added bonus for the child, but the fact that he obtains forgiveness. Okay, so the child breaks his toys, he says sorry, the mother says that's okay, don't worry about it. So that's how he got attention from his mother. So this racket is called Shamil, right? Okay, this leads directly to another game called Anti-Shamil. Anti-Shamil is played by not offering the demanded absolution. For example, after the child says, I'm sorry. Okay, now let's say the host, now let's say they're adults, right? So this is the child mind, right? So the host of the cocktail party, the host, instead of muttering, it's okay, says, well, you know what? If you're going to embarrass us, you're a guest in our home here. If you're going to embarrass us and spill coffee on the furniture or whatever, well, then, you know, I guess you're going to have, that's what you're going to do. So she doesn't give the, person forgiveness. So here, the mother role, or the adult in this case, switches from being a forgiving parent to being an objective adult who takes full responsibility for having invited her son's friend in the first place. The intensity of the child's game will be revealed by his reaction, which may be quite reactive. One who plays anti-Shamil runs the risk of causing narcissistic injury to the other person's vanity script. So one child felt that he got attention by breaking things in the home or something. The mother got a reaction. The child learned that if he says sorry, the mother's going to soften up and say, oh, that's okay. The child thought, wow, that's the first time mother was nice to him. The child's going to think that was the first time that the mother was nice to him. When he provoked her to say, that's okay. The child goes, wow, that's the first time the mother was nice to him. Now, how did he get that? First, he had to create the mess. Then he said sorry. Then the mother was nice to him. Imagine if that stuck there. Now imagine this person grows up and is an adult. They're at some kind of a cocktail party or something. And he spills the drink on the carpet or something. And he says sorry. And the host says, oh, that's quite all right. Don't worry about it. He feels a little, oh. The question is, did he spill the thing unconsciously on purpose to get the forgiveness from the host? If he did, that's the game called Shamil. Now, let's say he does it again. He does some other thing, and he says sorry. And he's always saying sorry for things, and the other person says, it's okay. Maybe he's stuck like that. Now, what if the host says, wait a minute, I invited this guy. It's one thing for him to spill the drink, and now he wants me to forgive him? So the host said, well, if you're going to spill the drink, spill the drink. If that's what you're going to do, that's what you're going to do. So she leaves it at that. Now, the other person might think, oh, you're not going to say that's okay? So she interrupted his little unconscious repetition compulsion. So ironically, the host was being therapeutic for the person, if he can recognize it. A little obscure, but this is just one example of the kinds of things he's talking about here. Another way of putting it, in Shamil, i.e. making messes and then apologizing. Okay, so in this racket, or in this game called Shamil, meaning first you make a mess and then you apologize, the benefit, the payoff he's looking for is to obtain the forgiveness, which is prompted by the apology. Okay, now causing the mess and the confusion and then apologizing, these are only steps leading, right, for the forgiveness. Okay, so he's stuck there. thinking that the only way someone is nice to him is when they're is when he's being forgiven or something like that. So that's in his book there. Okay, I'll just leave it at that, I guess, for Eric Byrne. See, I'm taking his work in small doses because it's a little kind of a... It does sound reductionistic. It sounds overly simplistic. People might be offended by this or... but he spent his whole life recording and researching and cataloging that these are the different gambits that people engage in interactions. Why? To avoid intimacy, to avoid heart-to-heart conversation, because heart-to-heart conversation, that's I'm okay, you're okay. The child didn't get that. The child stuck with either he's not okay and you're okay, or he thinks falsely that he's okay and you're not okay, and he's stuck there. So the games come from that aberration, that trauma. Yeah. And that's his theory there. It's a contribution, you know. It's part of the self-awareness movement, Eric Byrne's work. Okay, let's just take another little glimpse out here. How are we doing? Yeah, okay. Okay, the next four quotes. I came across a book called I just came across a book last night called Hollywood on the Couch. I thought, oh, this is interesting. So I'll just put a couple of quotes in it. That's an interesting book. If you want a entertaining educational book, it's called Hollywood on the Couch by Farber and Green. And he talks about the role of psychoanalysis in film, the influence psychoanalysis had in certain films. For example, Spellbound, The Lady in the Dark, and a couple of others, right? Can you guess which famous actress said this? I can't stand it here. It's too quiet. And one therapist said to this famous actress, when you don't have a lot of noise around you, the noise inside you becomes overwhelming. Okay. So I'll leave it. I won't give you the answer. You'll have to read the book to find out the answer. One of the points this book made was that the Hollywood shrinks. This book makes an interesting point. The Hollywood shrinks. Most of the time, they couldn't really be a shrink because most people in the Hollywood industry are on something, and that prevents the therapy, right? You can't do therapy if someone is on whatever they're on, right? So most of these shrinks, they're handholders. They're just nursemaids. They can't really do the therapy process, right? And... So a lot of famous people tried it and didn't work because in order for it to work, you first got to get off the, you got to detox and then maybe, but a lot of them are dependent. The analytic perspective, for the most part, it's not going to work if the person is so, if the brain chemistry is so dramatically altered, your conscious mind, it's yeah, I don't know how to explain it, but I'll just have to leave it as a question mark here. But but I thought that was an interesting point, that most of these Hollywood shrinks weren't really shrinks. They were just handholders, just get band-aids. They were just to get people through. They were what they call supportive, just to get people through an emotional outburst, but there was no therapeutic process. And when the movie Spellbound came out about psychoanalysis, there was a big controversy among the sort of the more authentic psychoanalytic community and sort of the Hollywood side of it. And there was this big commotion about it. And that in itself would make a movie, if you, as described in the book there, Hollywood on the Couch. That's a very dramatic story in of itself. And the lead shrink, the lead head Hollywood shrink, a woman by the name of Ram, May E. Ram, you know, she offered a lot of help to the Hollywood side, but she, some of the more quiet analytic researchers think that. So there was a split there between the genuine analytic approach, right? For example, as described in this comic series, right? And the more sort of supportive side. So in the movie Spellbound, for example, they use little crumbs of ideas about psychoanalysis, but they didn't teach it properly. Like, they didn't teach about unconscious guilt fully or properly. So, and Hitchcock, who was the director, he even said, oh no, we're not going to teach, this movie's not going to be a part of the mental hygiene movement. It's just another whodunit story, detective story. But he just wants to make it sound elegant, he's going to sprinkle in some psychoanalytic jargon in there. So it was sprinkled in, but it was confused. So for the person watching it, they're going to be impressed maybe with the jargon, but they're not really going to authentically learn about unconscious guilt. Now in the core collection, I posted a few clips from it, and I tried my best to clarify some of the points made about unconscious guilt. So the child has magical thinking, he thinks it's all about him, right? So he believes he can make things happen. That's a part of it. And if there's a repression of painful memories, something might trigger it and bring it up. Sometimes there's identification with someone else. I'm starting to forget it myself. But in the core collection, I'll have to review that movie. In the core collection, we posted a few quotes from the movie Spellbound, and I think I tried to clarify some of the points. It takes a bit of time, and I have to see the clip to be reminded of it. It's very muddled up. It's extremely muddled up. It takes a while to untease and unpick it all. So, for example, the child had an accident. It was very traumatic, and he blotted it out, right? So he wasn't aware of it. Later on, as an adult, he witnessed something that resembled what he did as a child that he didn't remember. He witnessed it. It brought it up as a defense against being reminded of what he did as a child. Okay, he takes on the role of the victim, because he learned about the victim. So he pretends to be that person as a defense against being reminded of what happened, of his guilt from a childhood. That's part of it. So when the dream came up and he became aware of it, and things got cleared up. But this got blended in with another point. One guy was genuinely guilty of something, but the naive shrink, she was new, she would say, no, you just believe it because children believe this. They feel so responsible for everything. So if you feel guilty about something, you didn't really do a bad thing. But he actually, so she couldn't distinguish the difference between when a person feels guilty and he's not, okay, versus when a person is guilty, right? So there was that element there. And there are a couple of other things. So that's, you can, so I can see why there's a lot of controversy about this movie. It's an excellent movie, Spellbound. It's still probably the one of the best movies about psychoanalysis, even though it doesn't properly teach it. But it does include some of the ideas in it as a starting point. So that's what this next one's about. One guy from Hollywood is Mankiewicz. He was part of the campaign to block that movie Spellbound because he thought it wasn't authentic. Anyways, there was an interview with him. Somebody asked him, so you use the flashback techniques in many of your films. For example, All About Eve, right? It's very unique to your work. His reply is, well, I don't think you'd be here today without your past. So the flashback technique is to help a person understand what's going on in the present. So you flash back to a childhood scene, then that helps the person to understand and remember and how that past is influencing them in the present. So one of the advocates of, one of the supporters of psychoanalysis was this guy, Joseph Mankiewicz or something. Okay, another quote from this book, Hollywood on the Couch. Not long after delivering the enormously successful Gone with the Wind, the producer, some guy named Selznick, experienced postpartum depression. Okay, so he delivered a baby, right? The baby was this famous movie. So, okay. So then he went to see this ROM woman we talked about. So that worked out quite well for him. And then he asked her to serve as consultant on Spellbound. So I thought that was an interesting little bit of trivia, movie trivia about Spellbound. Okay, we'll do one more here. Okay, in this film, Lady in the Dark, the psychiatrist summarizes her problem. He says, quote, what you are facing now is rebellion. Rebellion at your unfulfillment as a woman, unquote. Okay, so the woman is Lisa. Lisa's fulfillment will come not in sublimating or channeling her frustration, her unmet needs for love through work, but in embracing the traditional female roles of loving wife and helpmate. Okay, now this was a play originally, right? So the play, Lady in the Dark, ran for 467 times on Broadway. And if the psychological underpinnings seem too simplistic today, at the time, back then, they struck the audience like a thunderclap. Okay, so it was a big hit back then, right? And it was so popular back then that one film company paid a colossal sum for the movie rights. Now, the film version released in 1944 was very diluted. So I thought that was worth noting. Because the film, it's pretty good. And he says here, it's very diluted. So I thought, oh my God, can we see the play? Let's see the original. Let's see why the audience was so enthusiastic about it. So since these last four quotes came from a book called Hollywood on the Couch, I thought I would play a song about Hollywood. Here's a song about Hollywood by the band Streetheart. If you listen to the lyrics, he's saying, Hollywood, they chew you up and spit you out. Here comes the fool. So it's about how aggressive this business is of Hollywood. So here's the live version of it by Streetheart. Do you want to hear a bit of the? Do you want to hear a bit of the studio? That's the live one. Here's the studio one. Well, it sounds very similar. Actually, I was thinking about playing another song from the movie starring Ginger Rogers called Lady in the Dark. Because that movie talks about psychoanalysis, right? Lady in the Dark. And the main song for that movie is called My Ship. Lady in the Dark. And so I thought maybe I'd play. And I noticed this song was composed by a guy named Kurt Weill. And it's not bad, so maybe why don't we play a bit of this, huh? Yeah, this must be a promo for the play, this one here, Lady in the Dark. Oh yeah, that's the promo for the play. Hey, wait a minute. Is that the play? Hold on a sec. Let's check. What is this? Hold on a sec. Okay. I haven't checked this yet. What is this? Classic musicals from the golden age of radio. Oh, it's a musical. Oh.
Hi, I'm Michael Weber, artistic director of Chicago's Porchlight Music Theater. Opening at the Alvin Theater on January 23, 1941, Lady in the Dark brought the international star Gertrude Lawrence back to Broadway, where she had triumphed in the musical plays Tonight at 8:30, The International Review, Treasure Girl, OK, and Andre Charlotte's Review of 1924. Considered startlingly avant-garde in 1941 for both its structure...
Hey, hold on. What is this? Is this the play?
What do you mean by that, Liza?
Oh, there's the play.
Aren't you feeling any better?
Oh, yes, dear, a little. But anything wrong,
Jack? No, darling. And I don't think that you will have to see your Dr. Brooks anymore.
Oh, that's good. So we got an audio. This is a radio play version. Well, that's good. Okay. So that might, that's, oh, I'll look forward to listening to that one.
Oh, finally, Liza, finally.
I know, but...
Well, it's what we've always wanted, Liza.
Yes, dear, but oughtn't we to talk about this?
Talk about it?
Well, I mean, I didn't expect it just now.
Why, Liza, you astonish me. I simply...
Well, here's what I wanted to play here, the music, right? So here's the main song for that play in the music. It's called My Ship here, this one here. Sort of a melancholic sort of song. Oops. And the and she says basically that, you know, money without love is nothing, right? Basically one of these things. So she can have all the wealth in the world, but what she's looking for is love. So finally she found love. So this is a story about a woman who's afraid of closeness, right? And and they found out why she was afraid. And then in the end, she embraced being... she was okay with the idea of a traditional marriage. It allowed her a chance to be to get in touch with her feelings that way. Can't really hear it, can you, right? It's not very loud, huh? But this composer who wrote this music for this movie, Lady in the Dark, he has another song in here that's not bad called Allegro alla Marcia. Let's play this other one here. A little more upbeat one, right? Well, this is the nicest winter day we've had so far. Let's take a look at the west side. That's pointing east. Let's see how it is on the other side here. Hold on a sec. Okay. There's the sun's coming out now, yeah. Thank you. Okay. Hopefully you're seeing this. Sometimes my camera lots of snow today, right? Yeah, I feel like today's video I was sort of I'm sort of in a lighthearted mood. I'm in a kind of a I'm in an odd mood today. I'm not sure what it is. The combination of Eric Byrne's... I think Eric Byrne, his material is a little triggering, his material, I feel. Yeah, and reading that Hollywood on the Couch movie, that's also a little triggering. Brings up memories, right? So I'm feeling a little... But this guy's pretty good here. Kurt Weill. He's a composer. Never heard of him. Well, I guess I'll just wind it down here. So we talked about, we did the Lombardi, the importance of the body-mind connection, but only the spoon knows what's in the pot, so only we can feel our feelings. It takes two people to row a boat. That means we have to be conscious and responsible participants in our healing journey. Projective identification, coaxing others to play roles or to feel we're not, or to feel what we're feeling, right? To preserve the repression because we can't feel it. This goes back to the misattunement by the mother. A couple by Byrne there. Eric Byrne's story, I feel a little... Yeah, he worked his whole, he spent his whole life helping others. I wonder how much happiness he found himself. But anyways, he contributed, he helped others. I'm sure he felt some satisfaction in his work. And we did a couple of quotes from the book Hollywood on the Couch. We'll have some more quotes from it. I just started it. But... I didn't realize how prevalent the use of meds was or still is in Hollywood. Hence that song by Streetheart, Hollywood, you know, they don't care, you know, about you really, right? One of the promoters of psychoanalysis in Hollywood is Joseph Mankiewicz, and he uses a lot of flashback techniques, and he said that stories about men are pretty straightforward. He says it's trying to understand women that's the issue. So a lot of his movies are about women, and he's still trying to figure out and understand women. And so he spent a lot of time trying to understand women. He says for men it's pretty simple, in his opinion. This thing about her story here, Hollywood's number one shrink, Miss Rom there. There's not much information about her, but. Apparently, she had a very strong personality. People liked her because in her presence, people felt uplifted in her presence. So it was more about who she was rather than what she said or what interpretations she may have had. It was her personal charisma and her personal energy that she had the same kind of energetic strength that a lot of these producers, I guess, had. And a lot of movies, a whole movie could be created based on that book, Hollywood on the Couch. It's really like a soap opera, that book, you know. And, but overall, I'm not sure how well Hollywood did in promoting psychoanalysis. I think this did a better job, to be honest with you. This one comic book series, I think overall it does a better job than all of Hollywood put together, maybe. Well, that's an exaggeration. But this comic, although there were only 4 issues put out back in 1955, these 4 issues demonstrate the therapy process. There are 12, altogether there are 12 therapy sessions, right? So there were 4 with Freddie, 3 with Ellen, and 5 with Mark, right? Tales of Inner Turmoil, right? People searching for peace of mind through psychoanalysis. So they do dream interpretation, repetition compulsion. Unconscious guilt is covered in here. Yeah, unconscious guilt. You know, the child felt disappointed. So he recreates that. That's his script. He goes around creating disappointment to say that when he was a child, he was disappointed. So that's the script around unconscious guilt, right? Okay, I mentioned that song by Gabriel. Why don't we close up with that Gabriel song? It's all about, she says in this song, it's all about mutuality, right? It's about mutuality. It's about adult, it's about making I statements. If you're triggered, talk about what happened, right? And so it's give and take that way. It's a very good song by Gabriel. One of us is trying and one of us is in denial. The way to get out of denial is to read Eric Burns' book. That's a wake-up call, that book, isn't it? Read Eric Burns' book and this comic, right? That should be... That'd be a good start. And we'll have more quotes on projective identification and the body bears the burden. And we'll have more quotes as well about the narcissist pattern, right? Mommy's in denial, right? So he's in denial, right? Remember this one here? Narcissist. So he wasn't seen. He wasn't seen for who he was. So he lost his true self. So his true self got disassociated. So he's in denial, right? He's still looking for mother's loving gaze. You see? He's fused. He's still stuck with unmet symbiotic needs. Okay? So this one interpretation of this is that the baby's in a symbiotic state with the mother, right? So in his mind is a concept of himself and the concept of his mother, and it's fused there. You see? So that's what this means. So this and this are both, so this and this are inside here, and it's reflected here. So that's, so this, all of this is in here, right? And he's stuck there. I think this is what this means. And he's fixated here. He's stuck there, right? Now, the baby needs the mother. He sees the mother here because he is the mother. So he sees that now he needs her. And he's waiting for her love, and he's fused there. So this is the time of the original bliss with the fusion with the mother. Right? So the baby's at the breast, right? So the breast is there, he's at the breast, right? A concept of the breast, right? And that time, he feels self-sufficient because it's just him and the breast. He doesn't need other things. The baby only needs his mother, and there's his mother. The mother in the mind, there's the mother in the mind. He only needs the mother in the mind. So that's all. That's why if he has relationships outwardly with other people, right, he ignores them, right? Right? So if this is Peer Gynt, Solvig is over here, right? He runs away from Solvig. Echo, if this is Narcissus, he runs away. He ignores Narcissus. So he ignores his feelings. So he's in denial of this. He's in denial that his feelings are outside. Meaning disassociated. They're inside, but he's not aware of it, so it's shown as outside, but it's not outside. Now, his behavior in life is greed, because he's still trying to get... In order to leave this, in order to separate from the breast, he needs love from the breast to accept his feelings. So when he goes into the world and he's so greedy in the world, ambitious and greed and selfish and doesn't care about others, he projects the need for the good breast onto others. Now it can't be met, so he's like Sisyphus, so he's stuck there. Right? So the idea is to not be in to mourn the loss of not being... of not getting his symbiotic needs met, of not being seen. He's got to mourn the loss that he's still trying to get here. He's still trying to get what he can't get. Narcissus is still trying to get what it's impossible to get. Right? So in the song, in the movie Lady in the Dark, at the very end there, she accepts her feelings. Right? But he didn't. He never accepted his feelings. Right? So we'll have more quotes as well on the narcissistic pattern. There are a few other points around that as well. By the way, here's a from the West view. I never seem to catch a sunset. Here's why I go to the West side. I'm trying to show you this. Here's a glimpse of the sunset. Here's the West view. Right? I seem to miss it sometimes, but this is what I'm... When I go out to the show you the West Side, this is what I'm trying to get you to see. I don't know if you can see it here too well, but there's the sunset there. And On a lighter note here, I once tried to do this video in the car. Here was my introduction to it. Okay.
Hello. A change of venue for this video due to the rain. So this will be done in my car.
I once tried to do one of these videos in the car. I went around looking for a spot. I couldn't find one. I got interrupted. So I finally found a spot. When I arrived at that moment, it started to rain. So that's why I was laughing there. I guess I want to make the viewer happy. I feel like I want the viewer to enjoy these videos. I'm trying to add some levity to it. We talked about, here's a good one about the Odyssey. In previous videos, we've had a discussion about the Odyssey here. So if narcissists or Peer Gynt or Don Juan or the Playboy or the Womanizer or the Hollywood producer, whatever, if they finally realize that they're being like Sisyphus, then they're going to go on the journey to find their feelings. So he's en route to find his feelings. Now, while en route to find his feelings, there's a temptation that tells him it's too difficult. So he resists the temptation. So that's what this is about, right? So we'll have more quotes on the story of the Odyssey there. And why don't we just end up with that flute player? So here's a song called Splendor in the Mountains by Sikani Purizaka from Peru, an indigenous singer, a flute player from Peru. He talks about the splendor in the mountains. He promotes awareness about the beauty of nature. So here's a little bit of Splendor in the Snow. Every time you accept some emotion that was previously repressed, one theory is that we can symbolize this by an inner marriage. So the moon side, this represents our feeling self, what we don't know about ourselves, our feelings. Now, our consciousness, that's the sun there, that's our consciousness. It's sometimes called the masculine side, our consciousness, because it's active. So when we actively use our mind to know what we're feeling, and we accept our feelings, and we bring up something from the moon. You see the moon, it's within, it's inside of us. Right? So there's the body, there's the feelings. Body, feelings, right? When we accept our feelings, the act of accepting our feelings, it brings new life. You see, it brings something new. It's a creative process, right? To reintegrate into ourselves something that we don't know about ourselves. In myths and fairy tales, that's symbolized as a wedding. So when there's a marriage or a wedding, okay, that's a moment when we accepted our feelings, right? It's a wonderful thing, and that's why there's a new spark of life there. This spark, this newness, this fresh spark of vitality, it was in here, right? It was down here, or it wasn't available. So when we are conscious of what's unconscious,
we get new vitality. Okay? So this is the peace, right? This is a symbol of inner, so this is a symbol of inner peace. Inner harmony, inner peace. Inner harmony, inner peace. We accept, right? That's why he was saying we gotta put more emphasis on that first quote there. That first quote here, 8/19/18. Okay. We often take for granted the body-mind connection, right? So let's keep in mind the body when we talk about psychoanalysis. Don't forget about the body and how you're feeling and all of this. That's what he's saying there. So Eric Byrne gave an example of that. What do you notice in your body? You can start with your sensations. Remember the movie Inside Out? They divide sensations and feelings into two worlds. In that Disney movie, at the console there, you had fear and anger, the characters fear, anger, and disgust there. That's sort of physiological, biological sensations. Our feelings, okay, are grouped under the categories of joy and the two characters, joy and sadness, encompass our feeling self. So our feelings was in the unconscious. At the console, we had our sensations. So you know, you might first notice your sensations. Right? And when you accept them, the feelings can come back up. And at the end of the movie of Inside Out, the feelings came up in. See, when joy and sadness, those characters, came up into the console and they were together with the sensation, that brought up the sensation. So that's very similar. We could say that's sort of a modern version of that conjunctio painting here, right? So we could say there was a reunion there. So in some way, if we're aware of our feelings, there can be, right? So anything else here? Yeah, we once played this cartoon. So here's a quote about projective identification. So here's the, okay, I'm beginning to think he's crazier than I am. So here's the client, he's in denial, and he's coaxing the other to feel what he's not feeling, and it's making him angry. He's like, oh my God, I'm so angry. So that's what this is about. Now he's acting out his anger instead of interpreting it. So he's trying to, come on, loosen things up here, stop being in denial. But so he's just coaxing him to feel what he's feeling, and now he's feeling angry. So he's feeling angry, but he doesn't know it. He gets him to feel angry, now he's acting out. He's trying to loosen, he's trying another technique. So it's just sort of a silly idea there. So if the therapist does act out, he's got work. He still has personal work to do himself. Right? Anything else here? I'm not sure why I'm dawdling here, why I'm delaying. I'm just wondering if some kind of... Let's just do one more here. According to one theory, we all evolved from this guy. So for 1 million years, Homo boduensis, right? We were all Homo boduensis. And about 150,000 years ago, his brain evolved. He got the cortex, language, right? Awareness of himself. So Homo voduensis evolved to Homo sapiens. So we all came from this guy. That's what we all have in common. And the basic theory is that every baby needs a secure attachment style. If the baby has a secure attachment style, he ends up with natural, normal, healthy development called I'm okay, you're okay. That's normal, natural, healthy development. If there's some confusion, the baby ends up with I'm not okay, you're okay. Or anything other than I'm not okay, you're okay leads to the types of things that are described in Eric Byrne's book. Right? So the goal is to heal anything other than I'm okay. Anything other than I'm okay, you're okay, to heal it, to get to I'm okay, you're okay. That's the moral revolution, to get to I'm okay, you're okay, because that's what Homo sapiens is. That's what we are. We are all okay, right? So the moral revolution is for everyone to feel that they're okay and others are okay, right? Because that's what Homo sapiens did feel for 150,000 years, according to one theory, because all babies got a secure attachment style. But then babies stopped getting a secure attachment style roughly at about 10,000 years ago. Okay, now some benefits of that, some problems with that. We got some material gain, but we got some. Well, that's even a big question mark. Some people say that with I'm okay, you're okay, humans live a long life. That's a big question mark. But one theory is that with I'm okay, you're okay, we live longer, or healthier, we live longer. 120 was the average, they said. It can go up to 150, they said. But with the aberration, it's way too reduced. It's too much stress. Traumatizing the baby causes too much stress. Now, in the manic around all this, we invented so many things. Maybe it's to get us to the place where we can calm down and feel that we're okay again. I'm not sure. But no matter how we look at it, normal, natural, healthy development is I'm okay, you're okay. Because Homo sapiens are meant to cooperate, not compete. This is an aberration, this thinking that, anyway, that's for another topic. Okay, any last final thoughts here? Yeah, I guess we owe a little bit of gratitude to Mr. Pavlov here, right? He's one of the founders of psychology. Mr. Pavlov, okay. Looks like a humorous guy there. He's on a stamp there. So maybe he's one of the founders of modern psychology, I guess. One last look, hold on. Yeah, the sun's starting to come out again. So, one other thing here about the conscious and the unconscious. We have that painting by, what's his name again? Roy something here. Hold on a sec. Where is it? Yeah, this one here. So here's an interesting painting by Roy Lichtenstein. 1923, Oil and Magna on Canvas. It's called Stepping Out by Roy Lichtenstein. And okay, so he's conscious here, but so much of his what he doesn't know about himself is split off, so to metaphorically speaking, right? So he doesn't know this. This is his second self, his unconscious self, his shadow soul, the stranger within. There's someone who walks with him, who's not like him, but who is him. It's a part of him, but he doesn't know it. So this is his unconscious self, right? His alter ego, right? And now if there's too much trauma, that means a lot of his feelings gets put into here. And if he denies his feelings, right, then Bergler says this becomes the puppet master, okay? And it's going to engage in the repetition compulsion of trying to get a better outcome here, you see? And it's as if, metaphorically speaking, the stranger within has sort of a mind of its own, right? Hence the face there. It has a mind of its own. And it can, like, whisper to him and tell him what to do, and it sees for him. And you don't see this, you see what I see. So it can distort perception. So he may at midlife think, wow, something's missing in my life. What's missing? It's all of this. His golden ball is here. His feeling self is here. His true self is in here. His vitality is in here. Penelope is in here. Penelope. So if he's Odysseus, he wants to find Penelope. Okay? Right? Or in the fairy tale, the maiden king, it's the golden, it's the beautiful woman on the golden boat. Okay, his feeling self is here, his animation, right? So mind, body, you want to, okay, there's both here, right? And now Hollywood, interestingly enough, asks actors to tap into this and to role play some of this, you see? I'm reminded of Henry Winkler. In real life, he's not a very confident person. Right? In real life. It doesn't, it seems to be, right? He admits it himself. That's why I'm saying it. But when he has permission to role play his confidence, and he gets paid, and he gets a lot of support and applause and a high salary to role play some of his confidence, then he plays the fawns, right? So that's his alter ego. A lot of his confidence is in here. But in real life, he's afraid to integrate that confidence into himself. He only has permission to show his confidence when he's role-playing. You see, so in Hollywood, we role-play some of the things that we don't know about ourselves. And, you know, I don't remember, I don't think I even saw the movie All About Eve. I think I saw it briefly a long time ago. I'll have to check it out, but maybe, you know, yeah. But in literature, this is the motif of the double, right? So if you were to make this a character in a story and create a movie about this guy having a relationship with this guy, the question is, can he recognize that this guy is him? So in The Student of Prague, he didn't. You see? And that was the tragedy of that story, The Student of Prague. Right? So the idea is to own this. You see, he disowns all of this. All of this vitality, he disowns it. Right? He's afraid of his feelings. That's why he's so bland looking. You want to accept your feelings. How do you accept your feelings? Well, read games people play, recognize the script. Oh, okay. Then he can gradually start to understand it and bring some of it in, right? So eventually, his face will smile. He'll smile, shine, have a little bit more of a glow here, right? So he's looking for his vitality, his feeling self, right? So a lot of painful things happen in childhood, and that's what this means, right? I love that. That's a nice one. That's the spirit of creativity. Okay? This represents the spirit of creativity. Right? If you're gonna create a symbol of creativity, I think that's as good as it gets. That's a great one, I think. By the way, this book, I noticed there's an online a version of this book called Talking to the Sun. One last... Okay, we'll end up on this nice view here. Okay, this is as nice as it gets. Look at that, eh? I hope you're seeing this, but this is a... If this is showing up, we got the snow, we got the blue sky. The sun is out. Talking to the Sun. Okay, so on that note, I'll just end it here for today. So thanks again. We'll have more quotes. We'll keep adding quotes. Robert Bly says, read psychology every day for 10 minutes. I'd like to think that with each video, there's 10 minutes worth of reading below. If you click the See More option on the YouTube video here, you'll see the quotes. All of the quotes are posted below. Robert Bly keeps telling people, read psychology every day for 10 minutes. Even if it's a blur and you're just skimming it over, that's okay. Just glance at it or skim it. That's fine. Don't make it uncomfortable. If you find something you like, oh, that's great. You can read more about that, right? So it needs to be enjoyable, right? And coming up in future videos, we'll have a few more quotes on from that book Hollywood on the Couch. We'll have a few more quotes on dream interpretation, and a few more quotes on symbiosis, one of our threads. So that'll be coming up in future videos. All right. Okay, I promise this will be the last one. This is our theme song. This is our theme song to this collection is Windmills of the Mind by Katja Epstein. Let's try the West Side. This is Katja Epstein singing in German the song Windmills of the Mind. This collection of quotes is named after this song. Okay. Yeah, the views from here are a little difficult. Have I ever shown you my bowls here? Aren't they nice? There's a nice one there, right? This is really the perfect song. This is really the perfect theme song for this collection of quotes. Windmills of the Mind. We now have over 1,900 windmills of the mind. Ideas and insights and speculations, approximations, support to build the ego, to build the basket, to get the egg, to get the golden ball. So we're trying to get our golden ball. We need the key. The key's under the pillow. Where's the pillow? There is none. We have to understand, heal the splits, forgive the parents. Then we get the key to the golden ball. I promise, when Hetcher Epstein sings the final note, I'll hit the stop button. And with that, I'll see you in the next video. My timing's a little off there. Okay, thanks again. Bye.